Hello, hello, everyone. Welcome for joining us for today's Quasar Alchemy live stream featuring Mark Irwin and hosted by Jay Yowler. Thank everybody for coming in today. And in a moment, I'm going to turn it over to Jay Yowler. I'm just waiting for everyone to get in here. Hopefully, everybody can hear us okay. Really excited today about today's live stream. So, without further ado, I would like to introduce one of my favorite people in the world, a man who taught me most everything about lighting that I know today. I'd like to introduce Quasar founder and my partner and chief lighting technician, Jay. Yeah.
Hi, Stephen. How are you? I'm great. Great. Thank you, Stephen. Yes, I am Jay. I'm one of the founders of Quasar Science. This week we have Mark Irwin, ASC, CSC, to basically take a look back on his career and a look at our present day in film and the growth of new lighting fixtures in the industry. I've had the pleasure to have gaffed many, many films with Mark, and not only look up to him as a mentor, but as a friend and someone I've always thought of as another father. Mark has a very long career. He's got over 144 feature films, including Hanoi Hilton, Bat 21, Videodrome, Scanners, The Dead Zone, one of my favorites, The Fly, some movies that he and I did together, Nightmare on Elm Street, Scream, Vampire in Brooklyn. He's also done dozens of documentaries in the late 60s as well. Mark, out of all the films you've shot, which one would you say is your favorite, and tell the viewers why?
Now, I've just lost some of your audio there, Jay.
Okay, oh. I was just saying that out of all the films you've shot, which one was your favorite and why?
Well, first of all, let me clarify, of the 144 films I've done with you, Jay, 65 of them have done with you in Hollywood and different places in Vancouver. So of all the films that I've shot, and this one was not shot in North America even, was shot in Borneo in Malaysia, and it's called Bat 21. I was lucky enough to do two Vietnam movies. One was an indoor movie, Hanoi Hilton, which was all about people in prison, John McCain and others who were POWs. And then I got to go and do a full-on battleground movie with Gene Hackman, who was trapped behind enemy lines, one of those based on a true story kind of movies. And we went to Malaysia, and the equipment came from Toronto, and the gaffer came from Toronto. I still lived in Toronto at the time. There was a Hollywood grip, an all-Malaysian crew. We trained everybody. An American camera crew. We trained a bunch of Filipino guys and just had nothing, literally nothing. We needed trucks for the gear, and they said, "Oh, we don't have trucks. We have open trucks for people and stuff, but not closed trucks. We don't do that in Asia." And this was 1987, and they were right. They didn't. So we ended up with four shipping containers that were strapped to flatbed trucks, and we fitted them out as camera truck, camera grip electric prop trucks, which makes me think to today how we should work. Everyone their own container should go onto a flatbed and drive off to shoot, and what's done, come back in a yard where everything. You basically have your own truck without wheels. The production supplies the wheels, but I'm getting ahead of myself. That's my favorite. And it was the kind of film where the scope of it was huge, and literally the danger was huge. We had a a special effects guy who, an American who had lost his license for having killed someone on a film called Tora, Tora, Tora. Couldn't work in America, so he was in the Philippines. He was all over everywhere else, in Hong Kong, in Indonesia. And he almost killed us as well. I look back on it not so fondly, but yeah, it's still my favorite film.
That's great. Yeah, now, you've told me a lot of stories in the past. Did either of those films have an orangutan in it and a certain camera operator that had to be very still and the orangutan grabbed him by the back of the shirt? Or am I thinking of some other movie?
You're thinking of that movie, but it wasn't. He was the camera operator. It wasn't on set, though. And now I have a chance to tell everyone who's watching what I learned in Malaysia and the Bahasa language. Orang means jungle. Utan, no G, no Utan means man. So the orang utan is a jungle man. And there was still there, in fact, preserve where a lot of orphans and homeless orangutans had lost their habitat because people were logging and they literally cut their home down. So this was a place that was now, there was no fence around it because these guys climbed trees everywhere, but they were fed and everyone was kind of at this preserve. So I went there with Matt, who was three, with my wife and with Eric Goldstein, who was the operator, was a focus puller in those days. Now he's a DP in Vancouver. And the guide was very good. They said, as much as you want, you can relate to these animals. But you have to remember that they hang by their arms and their legs all the time. So their arms and their hands are as strong as their legs. So if they want to get to know you, don't try to fight it because they have big teeth and they're very strong. So Eric was kind of a hairy guy. And they said, whatever you do, don't have a camera, bag, nothing, because they'll take them and they'll be in a tree and you'll never see them again. So my son, who was three, he was like a little kid, a little equally aged orangutan baby, I guess, whatever you call them, cub, monkey. Another thing to remember, difference between monkeys and apes. Monkeys have tails, apes don't. So orangutan is an ape. Something I learned that day. Oh, monkeys. Okay, right, I got it. He hung out with this other one called Noreen, and they kind of were eye to eye. And this giant guy called Winston came out of a tree and was sniffing all over the place and found Eric, who had a tank top on and shorts, you know, the whole deal. But he had kind of hairy arms. And Winston's hand came up and checked out the hair, started, and grabbed Eric's head by the hair, pushed him down in the mud, jumped on top of him, and we're all standing back. And the guide is saying, oh, this is fine. Like, doesn't look fine to me.
Did Eric think it was fine?
Yeah, he's got his face in the mud saying, what do I do now? Like, oh, no, don't do anything. And he started grooming him, the hair on his back. So let's go for a hike. So we go off and then come back an hour later, he's still there in the mud. But that had nothing to do with the movie. The movie was my favorite, but ask me more about other movies. I'm ready.
What year was Bat 21?
That was we shot The Fly in 86 and 87, and that was 1987. And that was the film that convinced me that I had to move to Hollywood, not the film itself, excuse me, but going through customs. I had a green card since 1980, still lived in Canada with an American wife. Got to the airport and the customs preclearance, it means you go through U.S. Customs at a Canadian airport. They looked at my green card and said, you're a resident alien. Where do you live? I live in Toronto. But it says you're a resident alien. You have to live in America as a resident alien. Where's your American address? Well, I'm freelancing it. And they said, don't go away. Took my green card. I got a kid and a diaper bag and everyone's yelling and screaming. I got to get on the plane. And 10 minutes, the guy comes back and he holds his card and says, I could keep this card and you would never get back into America again. And I'm thinking, I'll just grab it and run. No, not today. So that was like he helped me out with the kid. That's when it helps to have a screaming kid. And got on the plane, came back, and immediately moved to California.
That's great.
It wasn't like, oh, take your time. No, I can't. No time to waste. So that's how I got here.
Yeah, because it was right after that, shortly after that, is when I first met you. So what director did you enjoy working with the most?
I know that's a good question. People ask me that. And I've been lucky to work with some of the heavy hitters in the horror world, Cronenberg and Wes Craven. And those guys are great for a reason. They're very, 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 very organized. So it's, I want this, I want this, I want this. And when you say, well, how, no, this, and then this, yeah, how, no, this. So the greatness is kind of theirs alone. The guys that I've, two directors, because I couldn't decide. Peter Markle, who directed Bat 21, as well as Youngblood, and a couple of TV movies I did with him. He and I are on a good wavelength, so things will expand. And he'll go with that. We'll go there together instead of, no, I got a shot list. This is the next setup. Okay, so then you're just really the mechanical interpreter. You run the crew, but you don't have any input. The other director that I have worked with pretty well every year for the last 10 years is a producer, director, writer, creator in Vancouver. His name was Robert Vince. And he and his brother created Air Bud, the basketball playing dog, and ended up going beyond that into, his brother died, Bill died, and Robert took over and has done nothing but dog movies and has kind of perfected that. And he's a very, very, very prepared and open-minded person. These are the guys I love. If you and I have a lighting diagram and they have a shot list, I'm happy to put the lighting diagram in my pocket and say, oh, the sun's over here. Okay, let's do this. And they are willing to say, yeah, oh, I like that. Let's try that. I like that. We'll do that by the river instead of on top of the cliff. And that's the open mind that you look for with a director, because most of them are, it's my way or it's a wrap. All right, so I'm here to not wrap early. So, but yeah, Peter Markle and Robert Vince, those are my favorites.
That's awesome. As a cinematographer, you have to work really closely with production designers. Again, who is your favorite? And can you tell people why that relationship is so important on a film set?
Well, I'd managed to do 6 films with David Cronenberg, and Carol Spear was the designer on all of those. And the last film I did with David was The Fly, and Carol was the production designer. And this was in a studio, and she built a set inside a studio, which was a warehouse. And normally when you're in a studio, you kind of think, well, we don't need to lay track because we're building this floor. We don't need to put on a dance floor. She built the entire set with tongue and groove pine flooring instead of plywood painted to look like that. And I asked her why, and she said, it's not real. Okay, so now we've built a set inside a studio and we've turned it into a location. So that luckily worked out that I was obliged to kind of jury-rig and self-manufacture pneumatic tires for the Pee-wee, which is what we did. And Production Services was very good in developing that. So now we had air-filled tires that could go anywhere on the floor. But that was, I'm not saying this because I liked Carol Spear. I'm saying it because that's the kind of production designer who's not a partner. We said, I'm building Michelangelo's David, and you have a potato sack to light. You know, let's deal with it. My favorite production designer is a guy called Mark Hoffling. I did 2 Disney musicals in Puerto Rico and another Disney musical in Vancouver, and then all 3 were kind of period pieces with elaborate sets designed around how to light it, how to put the camera, in other words, he can literally get inside my head, look through the lens and say, oh, I see what you need, and build it that way instead of saying, this is what I do, you deal with it. And if you remember a film called Deck the Halls, we had a production designer who built wonderful outdoor set, literally outdoor set, 2 full-on built-to-code, Cape Cod-style houses, 2-story houses with a big street and a gazebo and trees and all that sort of thing. And it was like 3 acres. And they said, well, this is great. This is all about Christmas lights at night, shooting in Vancouver in the summer where it gets dark at 10:30 and gets light again at 4:30 in the morning. So what do we do? We're going to have to tent this. And he said, sounds like a plan. I don't do tents. That's your problem. So that's the kind of product which we eventually solved very elaborately and in a, well, anyway, compromise notwithstanding. Those are the production designers that you don't want to deal with, who build something and say, it's all yours. You know, I don't care. I've done what I want. So I look at this as a collaboration on every level. And certainly when it comes to the lighting department, the concept, because otherwise it's just black footage, you know, we have to light it. And it comes down to light for character, for mood. And people say, well, when you and I did Dumb and Dumber, we were shooting 2 weeks before, we were shooting Vampire in Brooklyn for Wes Craven, a big full-on vampire movie, you know, dark, dark, wet streets, the whole deal. 2 weeks later, we're in Utah doing a comedy. And I'd never done a comedy. I'd done a lot of Second City stuff. I'd done a lot of stuff in Toronto, which was comedic, but it wasn't a comedy feature. And the Farrelly brothers picked me. Oh, you seem like a nice guy. You want to make a movie? Yes, sure, whatever. And so you have to switch gears. So I've since talked about this, and people ask me about the look of There's Something About Mary or Kingpin. And I always say, well, I don't want Dumb and Dumber to look like Vampire in Brooklyn. That's shouldn't. Right. And Mighty Ducks 2 shouldn't look like The Fly. So you have to truly commit to the story. And in some ways, making people laugh. And that really, the mystery of that is how dark the shadows are. The Farrelly brothers were, in the beginning, they were very good. They had a creative kind of gallons and gallons of creativity that eventually kind of oozed out, and they ended up doing films like Movie 43 and Hall Pass, stuff like that. I wasn't involved at that point. You and I took over the last film I did with them, which was the Ringer.
That's right.
Johnny Knoxville. And these are full-on pratfall movies, you know, a pie in the face. That's the definition of comedy versus tragedy. Comedy is you getting hit in the face with a pie. Tragedy is me getting hit in the face with a pie. The same right. Action, different perspective. So when it comes to pie throwing, I honestly think I have to commit to the story. Jim Carrey was an interesting person. That was the first film from then on. That was 94. First film I used two cameras all the time. We started with one camera, and the director said, cut, okay, let's try this again. I want you to do what you just did. And Jim literally said, what did I do? I don't know. I just make it up.
Yeah.
And play it back. Well, don't play it back. I don't want to see that. Okay, so we have to get the wide shot and his close-up. So he was the variable. Having done dog movies now, the dogs are best trained, and you put B camera on the kid who will miss his mark and screw up, and the dogs will be like machinery. And somebody does comedy, even Bill Murray, he'll improvise, and he won't know where it started and where it was going to end. So matching it, it's not my problem. So get five cameras, I don't care. So from then on, everything's been two cameras, and lighting from two cameras is part of the I don't know, the strategy. It's a plus and a minus, but we'll talk about that.
That's right. I remember when we were doing Vampire in Brooklyn, you know, those were the days, 80s and 90s, because we were literally doing three movies back to back every year. But I remember we had done this run of horror movies, and after Vampire in Brooklyn, you came up to me and you said, you know what, we need a good comedy. And I was like, yeah, comedy would be great. Get out of some of these nights. And then literally like 2 days later, you go, well, we have this movie called Dumb and Dumber we're going to go do. So that was pretty cool.
Well, my motto has always been the same. I don't write them. I just light them. And that's our job.
That's true.
To take a story and put it on the screen, or, you know, in conjunction with all the other departments. And people say, oh, don't you miss the, you know, all this horror film? Why don't you want to do a horror film? And, you know, I think, okay, Wet Streets. And when we did The Blob, 17 weeks of nights.
That's right.
And wouldn't you like to? No, I don't want to. I don't mind doing kids' hours and having what's left of my life to be livable instead of committing to, man, these guys in Vancouver, the crews I get are so thankful to work days because they're working on Arrow and all these different shows that are massive 18-hour days with pre-lights and rain, constant rain, no rain machine, just fucking rain. So, I paid my dues. You wrote it, I did it, you know, the fly, whatever.
You've definitely paid your dues, that's for sure. Yeah. I have another question for you, and I have a hunch as to what your answer is going to be, but that's just what I feel, because we've talked about movies that could be a great movie to reshoot in with the technology we have today. If you had the opportunity to remake any of the films you shot, which one would it be?
Well, your hunch was close. I think the Videodrome, which was in the 80s, man, I forget what year it was. That was David's take, Cronenberg's take on the future. And his take on the future was that the future would be on VHS cassettes in a library instead of on a server, you know. That was the future as, oh, I can see that far. Whereas 2001, you know, HAL was this thing, and that was the future that other people saw. Nonetheless, he wasn't wrong. This was a grassroots thing. A lot of people want to remake Videodrome because its view of the future is now ancient history, and our future is much more interesting. That's up to David, and I've spoken to him about that. He doesn't want to direct anymore. The guy's 77, I don't blame him. He wants to write novels and not deal with getting up at 5 in the morning and driving here and compromising with that actor's performance. So the film I'd like to remake, would be, you ready for this? The Blob.
Well, that was my second choice because, you know, I worked on The Blob and I thought we did some really cool stuff on it.
Yeah.
With today's technology, though, you could even make it even better. But Videodrome was also one of those films that I thought, you know, would be a good one to remake. But The Blob is a good one.
Well, it was funny because there was very few CG. There wasn't computer generated, and that was 1988. Right after that, I did RoboCop in Houston, RoboCop 2. Virtually all of it was mechanical effects and some set extensions we shot at VistaVision, but The Blob was mostly real effects. It's still in so the world was left here and there. It's created all CG. And then it just feels old and creepy. There's nothing wrong with that. That's what people say. I do Criterion re-releases and do a commentary of this film that's now in a collection, and they say, and we've booked time for you to do a recolor, do a new DI, and the thing, yeah, recut the Irene Love and remake it in color. That was the notch in your belt. And that's behind me. And that's, to me, that's part of, well, that's the history of it all. I wanted to talk to you about numbers, ironically, because you and I started at different times with the same person. But let me ask you, where before the film business?
Well, you know, I ended up working in a machine shop and traveled with Steven's family in the circus. So it was all about creating things and you know, looking at ways to do rigging and this and that and the other. Working in a machine shop, I found after a year and a half that it just wasn't for me. But it's so invaluable, everything I learned by working in a machine shop to the things that I can do nowadays with design work and this, that, and the other. You're talking about The Blob and the mechanical features of effects and things like that. I just recently watched The Blob with my 13-year-old son, and he loved it. And the one scene that really holds up still is the guy getting sucked through the wall backwards.
That's funny, because I did a film with Chuck Russell, who directed The Blob, a couple of years ago, and he told me that there is a blob festival or series of festivals that people don't want to let it die. And in Florida, especially, there's a big blob fan thing. And it's like the Rocky Horror Picture Show. They watch the movie, and that is the scene.
That's
right. Those who don't know, you got to go check out the blob. But the blob goes from its intergalactic place into the sewer system, then into the water system. And we cut to the diner and the guy with the hairnet on who's washing dishes, and the sink's clogged up, and he sticks his hand down the thing, and then he gets drawn in completely. And everyone goes crazy. And you know what? When we did Scanners, when the guy's head explodes, everyone loves that moment. And in the blob, this is that moment. So that I love the mechanical effects. And in some ways, I think if you redid it all and made it all Xbox, whatever, superhero CGI stuff, then it becomes what it is, which is your head says, yeah, I know that's not real. This one was real. Because it was the guy and his body folded up, and yeah, that was great.
That took him a long time to heal from that. No.
Yeah. He wasn't half the man he used to be after that.
That's right. Let me ask you this. How have the numbers changed for you from 1973 to present, since you brought that up a minute ago? And I'm talking ASA-wise.
Yeah. And a lot of people who are watching or listening, perhaps I'm not the person who, I've been in the ASC for 32 years, and the ASC is now 100 years old. That's American Society of Cinematographers. And all the collections of cameras that we have go back to the beginning of the film business, of cinema, hand crank cameras and so on. So to get into color from black and white, these were now motorized cameras, like the Wizard of Oz, 1939, and Gone with the Wind. Those were some of the first big Technicolor cameras, and they used three strips of black and white film. Each black and white strip was color sensitive to only one color, red, green, and blue, and they'd combine them together and create color with just the print. So you were shooting film in a very elaborate way. That was, let's say it's 1940. I was born in 1950 and started in the film business in 1973. By then, I should say, Gone with the Wind, Wizard of Oz, ASA 5. That's all it was. You would go out in the morning and wait for the sun to come up and up, and then have meters. Okay, now we have enough light to roll a camera. You think, well, what are we going to do inside the studio? Watch and learn, you know. The Yellow Brick Road set had 280 yellow flame carbon arcs, just lighting everything to get what I call idiot fill, enough level to get an exposure. When I started, it was ASA 50. And the lenses were almost the same as they were in the 30s. The lenses were Baltars. They were wide open 3.5, and the zooms wide open. There was only one zoom. An ingenue 25 to 250, and it was 3.9. So in order to get an exposure, you needed start working at around 200 to 300 foot candles, which meant a lot of light, a lot of generators, a lot of electricity, and a lot of money. So inch by inch, all this would change. That was 73 when I graduated. Ironically, that was 35 mil. Producers would say, well, we're going to shoot in Super 16, and it's much cheaper and it's much smaller. My response has never changed. He said, everything's much smaller. Really? The dolly's smaller, the actors are smaller. What's smaller? What everything? And I always ask them, look at your thumbnail. In fact, do that right now, folks. Look at your thumbnail. That's a 16 mil frame. Now, how big is a movie screen? Or how big is a TV set? That ASA on that film stock was different. It was reversal. It was ASA 25 because it had to be fine grain to blow it up. So lighting these sets, you would start with a 10K and a maxi brute and another maxi brute and fill with a 5K and then rim with a 5K and deuces and power, cables. That's why a guy like Jock Brandes, who was the guy who inspired you and I, was so valuable. He was at heart a gaffer, even though the first films I worked on with him were porno films, shooting short ends with literally a rattle trap of a Mitchell camera that would, it was just crazy, catch on fire, the whole deal. But we needed a ton of light to do that. So that was 1973. Let's transpose ourselves to 2020. Here we are. Now the numbers are different. A native ISO of 800 and 1280 is kind of the norm. Now you can light a set with 10-foot candles, two 10-foot candles. The thought of a 10K, of a 5K, of a 9 light, they're not on the set. And my joke is that there is usually more light in the fridge at craft service than there is on the set. And that's what it's come to. Now, in where I started and went up through scanners and Videodrome and the Fly, in the Dead Zone, ASA kept rising. Lenses became faster. It became the norm. We shot the Fly on T1-3 lenses. By the way, that was the only film I could get David to not use a Panaflex and to shoot with Zeiss lenses and to put smoke on the set as an element, a kind of constant element. But now we reached a point at midpoint of all that where 5 pages, 6 pages, that was the most you could hope to get because it took a lot of light. And now at ASA 1280, turn on some lights in the corner and let's roll. Now producer said, wow, you can do that. Okay, let's do this episode in 4 days. Let's do 12 pages today. I have friends in Vancouver who do Hallmark movies. I don't know if they'll ever come back, but they would do 15 pages. 100 pages in 15 days. Now it's down to 10 days, 10 pages a day. It can be done because you don't need to light it. So where does the storytelling start? Where does the director who doesn't really have a fix on this find it? Where's his focus when we are shooting like crazy? So it went from maybe 10 to 15 setups a day at ASA 50 to now the expectation is 50 setups a day with two cameras. And we do them. So the numbers have been able, what this has done for me as someone who works with someone like you as a gaffer to translate raw electrons, into British thermal units, BTU, how hot is this set going to be? Literally, yeah. How bright is it going to be? And you started out with guys in Wilmington like Alex Thompson, who a 5.6 was wide open for him. He wanted that much depth. They were shooting anamorphic. They wanted it 5.6 and 8. And that's what when we did Scream, that was anamorphic, and we lit the shit out of it. That's what you do. Now it's different. People kind of, it's what I call look at me lighting and look at me framing. Now it's look at me focus with a blade of grass in foreground sharp and the rest is all out and there's a death scene happening. That bothers me, but nonetheless, that's what it's come to. I look at the character of light and how, in the beginning, how to get the soft, what looks normal to you and I, and I learned from a lot of British cameramen by example, and guys like Gordon Willis and Owen Reutzman, soft cross key and a kicker and a line, and not a lot of fill. That's where you get. The issue with all of us is that we deal with films that are starring upright biped human beings that have this big lump in the middle of their face. They had nice soft cross wash and then no shadow. So we worked hard at getting that light to wrap around the wrap factor, which is now part of a nomenclature for filmmaking. It started to get enough light level, 3 or 4 maxi brutes bounce into a bounce. It wasn't ultra bounce in those days. I forget what it was.
Grif.
And then it would, Grifflin, yeah. And then it would bounce. That bounce would wash enough that you could then either diffuse it or just live with that bounce to have a nice. Don't forget, I needed 100 foot candles on her face. Now you can do it with 3 foot candles or 7 foot candles. So inch by inch, the space needed to have a griff, a 20 by griff, 6 9 lights, or let's say it's a 12 by griff, 6 9 lights, and a 20 by silk, and now you've got that wash. Well, that's a lot of real estate. Now you want to do it in a location. What are we going to do? Well, we can get by with less, with blondes or 2K open face lights, bounce, diffuse, or just plain bounce. Or now, if we have less room, a direct light and diffusion. Okay, well, I need another diffusion. It's not soft enough. So let me turn the clock back to 1987, 86, when we shot The Fly. And Scotty gaffed that. Scotty was one of Jock Brandis's best boys. And Jock had then moved, after The Dead Zone, he moved to Wilmington and started. He was probably working with you then.
That's right. I
had this, one of the electricians was this tall, skinny East German guy who had a funny name and he had funny glasses. And he was one of those guys who would always look at things differently, not knowing that that was, not remembering that that was the Jock Brandis perspective, to see how something was, and to walk over here and think, well, why are you doing it that way? This could, anyway, that's the wheels turning. And this guy had his wheels turning, and he started trying to sell me and Scotty and different people in Toronto, here's how movies are going to be made. We're going to use fluorescent tubes. And we all thought he was crazy and literally told him, office lighting to light a movie set? No. And his name was Frieder Hockheim. And he stuck with it. And he's the guy who created Kino, all the Kino tubes. That made sense. And now I look at a tube nowadays with LEDs as a light source. And to me, those are, to be blunt, they are the 2x4s of lighting setups. The structure upon which everything rests. So now we've gone from bouncing a ton of light to diffuse it, to getting closer and closer onto the set, and the sets are getting hotter. Now we're using fluorescent tubes. We want to change different color temperature. Oh, well, let's change the gel. Let's change the tube. Let's change the fixture. Let's change the diffusion. That's what kills me, what I call the fuss factor. In other words, you're trying to set a shot, and there's somebody on a ladder till the last fucking minute, and then you got to roll. Wouldn't it be great to have tubes in any configuration, any size, from 1 foot to 8 feet, to put them here, to put them there, put them in place, and wire them, and that's it. And then to balance them literally with the stand-ins and with the actors. Oh, this guy's lighter than I thought. Okay, tune that down. I need this more, the halo light to be warmer. Let's dial it from 32 to 28, 26, that looks better. That would be, now I'm turning the clock back to 1973. Impossible, other than bringing the gel, bringing the lighting. 73, we didn't even have 216. We used this toxic material called spun glass, which was exactly that. It was fiberglass that you could get in your eyes and your lungs, it would kill you. And now you can, we can, put the lights where we want them and dial them as we go. And now the thought of a soft cross key is a wall of tubes or a lighting fixture. My deal with all of the quasars that I have from you is to make a soft box around it. So now this is a box of light, and it has nothing to do with the linear. The single tube is now a gang of 6, 8, 12 in a box that's a soft box, all diffusion, and hang them everywhere. This is now the open architecture that. And at one point, somebody said to someone in the Bay Area, they said, are you really sure people are going to want to take their computer home with them at night? I mean, you got the desktop and the keyboard and the mouse and the CPU, all the cables. And you think you want to make a version that they can fold up and take home or take anywhere? You know, there's no mouse. There's no battery. A little tiny screen. Are you sure, Steve? People want to do that? And Steve Jobs said, yeah, they do. I think they do. And Frieder said, yeah, I think they do. And you guys said, yeah, I think they do. And now lighting a whole set with LEDs is, well, of course, what is there, no other way? Well, there is another way, because I've been there. I've been lighting people to 600-foot candles. And now I'm amazed how dark sets are, especially when you go to a stage and you come in from outside and you go onto the set and it's like, no way, can't see anything. And yet the product is amazing. So the two things that have done that is high-speed lenses and high-speed CMOS sensors. now cameras can see in the dark. And now you're shooting, and now you can shoot at this, the 7-Eleven parking lot, and it's lit. We'll have to street down and roll. Start flagging streetlights and the big A&W sign. But, you know, that's now it's all about light management. And I found a lot of unlighting that we do is to key and rim and start dealing with negative to get rid of what I call alexophil. It's just there. And you want to get rid of it so you can't. You can play with the gamma in the camera. You can play with contrast, but everything is affected by contrast. So instead of a 20 by of bounce, now it's a 20 by of negative to kind of cove that shape back into the person. So the I mentioned about bipeds with lumps on their faces, that being this nose. I've been trying for years to find a way to get rid of that hard shadow and to soften it. And the glow of this diffused tube that is now completely adjustable, and you're not locked into a square wave issue. You want to shoot 27 frames, you can't, it's not 30 24 30 60 40, all the windows. And having shot a lot of family canine dog movies, some things, well, let's try this again at, can you do 27? Yes, we can. And 2 years earlier, it's got to be 30 or 24. So that's the liberty that the numbers have given me. You can now, you don't need anything really in terms of bright lights. But then a producer says, oh, okay, that means you can do 20 pages in 2 days. Yeah, it does. Unfortunately, that's where we're stuck. How long are the episodes that you've been working on lately?
We average eight pages a day. And, you know, one of my next things I was going to say to you was to tell the viewers that page count, eight pages a day is a lot. It's not a lot if you're shooting one person and it's a lot of dialogue. But what happens when you have eight pages a day and you have six actors on set that all have dialogue? Tell the viewers what that means for doing eight pages a day.
Well, there's something in terms of coverage. The meat and potatoes of coverage is a wide shot, a master, a mid shot, a loose over shoulder, and a tight over shoulder. And most directors fall into two categories. One category that feels safe getting that kind of coverage. And it's what I call the tyranny of the over, because studios definitely, because the showrunners tend to recut everything. The director says, there's my cut. And they say, thanks, goodbye. Okay, let's start. They say to the editor, he's gone. We recut it. They want all those pieces. So the two-shot, the over, the performance, the reverse, da, da, da. So now you've gone from a big wash of something to it's like a tile. All these pieces are what's vital. That's where the day goes. Finding the performance, especially with young actors, or actors. I did a film with Judd Hirsch, a courtroom drama where he had to say, Your Honor, I protest. And he'd walk around and talk, had to say all these lawyer lines. Couldn't remember one word. We had giant cue cards. I don't need cue cards. No. And he would go dry constantly. So the day would just be gone. You say, well, we have eight pages, but it's just guys talking. Yeah. So then there's the other director who says, I don't want to do conventional coverage. And if you watch a show like Law and Order, their method of doing three pages or four pages is a traveling group shot, the Law and Order shuffle, where everybody talks and talks, and then he comes in, you go there, he comes here, you go there, and you get it all. Yeah, well, the getting of it all is one thing. Then you have to light it, and then you actually have to shoot it. Steadicam, take three, take seven, take 12, who knows? But at the end of the day, literally the end of the day, when somebody says, well, we got 5 minutes to wrap, and you have another page to do, what are you going to do? So that is the great unknown. The beauty is if you have the director who goes around and around, this angle looks great because everyone's lit the way you want. Cross key, backlight. Suddenly, whoa, he's front lit. That's terrible. Now with LEDs, you can, they used to be called pull a dynamic, which is faded on the run. So the balance never goes away and the character of light never goes away. And if you're doing a show like a Grownish or Blackish, it's an up thing with a mixed race cast, and you have to light things for a reason and also to keep it happy, or what I call you're feeding the audience. You're not not everyone is in double, triple shadow and they have one little eye glint. It's there. Those are the directors who are happy to have coverage because they want to modulate. We want to say the producers, the studio says, well, where's his close-up? It's a two-shot, and she's telling him, what'd you do at school today? Da, 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 da. And then I met a boy. What? You want to cut to the dad saying, he said, what? And if you don't have that, if you're doing some 360, the studio is going to say, no. This is when we cut to. This is action, reaction. This is what TV is made of. This is the meat and potatoes. So our job is to make it all possible, the art of the possible, and to do it all. My standard thing, how long do you need? 20 minutes. Never say less. Definitely never say less. And never say more. 20 minutes. That's because it's not too much. I worked with an AD with David Cronenberg all the time. John Board, a great guy who was one of the early hippies. He was a beatnik before he was a hippie. So he had smoked more dope than anyone had ever grown. And he wore a stopwatch. 20 minutes? What do you? Okay. And because he would forget. You tell him something, he'd immediately forget it. So he had his reading glasses, the thing with pen, his radio, and then the stopwatch, tick, 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 tick. And he'd come, ding, and he'd come over to me, you ready yet? So some people don't forget 20 minutes, some people can't remember it. Either way, did that answer the question?
Well, it certainly did. And going back to one of the films you and I did together, which was The Mighty Ducks.
Yes.
We had all the kids on there, and I remember we had to shoot on every kid, whether he had lines or not, which meant at that time we were watching dailies every night. And on that particular movie, we were sitting at dailies for 2 hours until you came up with high speed zip through the dailies.
Yeah.
That seemed to work pretty well.
Well, what's interesting is on film, labs have a quality control engineer who's kind of the guru, the guy that we call at 4 a.m. before you go to work or 5 to see. He's been watching your dailies, but everybody's dailies. And their method of doing it is not only to watch it at high speed, because they're looking for scratches and any kind of chemical flaw. They don't want to get into the story, so they will have two projectors running with the image upside down. So they just look for that. And I'm thinking, there is such a thing as high-speed projectors. Why don't we do that? So we did. That's the kind of show where two things I learned from Dumb and Dumber and other comedies, always use two cameras, and it's elementary things. It's literally hair in the wind, clothing matching. You know, it's nothing worse than a two-shot and a single. It doesn't match. Hand gestures, the whole deal. But with that, with high-speed or really quality zoom lenses instead of primes on everything, you could have a 5-shot and then a 2-shot and then a single and a single and a single, and they're all reactions, and just hose it down. Because hey, it's a 12-hour day. I always tell producers the same thing: don't forget the sun is going down while you're eating breakfast. Don't pretend that the day started, oh my god, it's quarter to sunset, let's do something. That's the enthusiasm you need. I call, don't wait till it's, you know, obviously it's too late. But the hardest thing to make on a set, and this is something for most people to remember, the hardest thing to make on a set is to make up your mind. Have a whole crew with 6 trucks, everyone's ready with ladders and a director. Well, you know, just make up your mind. And all my guys will go to work, they get the ladders, the cables, the lights, they'll do it. And we can make the day if you can make up your mind.
That's right.
But, oh, come on.
Make a lot of and go with it.
An entry-level job, that's the joke on episodic shows. Entry-level job, PA and director. And the truth is, what we do every day is what we do every day. What they do once a year as a director is what they're trying to figure out now. So their reflexes, if you're training for a marathon, you're not going to get up that day and say, yeah, 26.2 miles, I'm ready, let's do it. I haven't trained, that doesn't matter. If you're a director and you direct 1 8-day or 5-day episode a year, you're not in shape. So trust the AD, trust the DP. I trust my gaffer, the key grip. It's all, and that's the joke. I guess it's because I'm Canadian. I always tell people, because especially in Vancouver, they get kind of, yeah, I'm from Vancouver. You know, I know everything. All right. I know. And I tell people, the film business is like a totem pole. no matter who you are or think you are, there's someone standing on your head.
So that's don't right.
Be careful. I'm in charge. No, you're not. There's a lot of people on top of me, and I'm on top of you. So let's get going.
Jock Brandes told me a story a long time ago about a film you and he did together, and it involved a belt sander that you guys had to paint lines down the middle of it to look like divider lines on a road. Tell everybody about what that was all about.
Well, I'll backtrack to this film. This is the first film I did with David Cronenberg. And David is known for horror films like The Dead Zone and other films I did with him. This was the first one, and it was a drag racing film called Fast Company. And if people are familiar with true AA funny cars or top fuelers, the top fuelers are the long ones. AA funny cars are look like a sedan, even though the entire body is made out of fiberglass reinforced plastic, FRP. And the body comes on and the car drives away. So mechanically, they're both monsters and they're both very dangerous. They use nitromethane fuel. When we prepped the gang boss for the crew, these were real drag racers. And he said, you have to wear earplugs and cans, ear protectors. And well, you know, I got to communicate. No. You have to use, because when these things blip the throttle, you can see the sound come at you. Your eyes start to quiver. And then if you don't have ear protection, you go immediately deaf and blood pours out of your ear. And he made this whole graphic thing. Okay. So we knew how dangerous it was. The whole story was the two teams competing their drag racing thing. The bad guy's going to cheat, of course. So he breaks the fuel line of the good guy's car. And it doesn't break it. He unthreads it. So during this quarter mile, we shot this in Edmonton, and at that time the world champion was a guy from Edmonton, Alberta. His name was Gordy Bonin, 240 Gordy Bonin. He would, in a quarter mile, go 240 miles an hour, just. And these producers said, "Well, we'll just use their cars to mount cameras." What are you, crazy? And this nitromethane, you cannot see the flames. You're suddenly burning. You're on fire. We melted one camera completely. It was mounted to the body where these leg pipes came out. All this heat would come out. So we wrapped it in asbestos, all wired in. It was perfect. It was on the body. They start the engine. We drop the body down. He blips the throttle. It blows off the asbestos, blips it again, and sets the camera on fire like a fucking marshmallow. And then takes off down the quarter mile. And my assistant is running after it. Like, yeah, you're going to catch it. Saying, curse, oh, helmet, the Panavision camera tech. Helmet's going to kill me. Helmet's going to kill me. And this is now in the lobby at Panavision in Toronto. This big blob of melted aluminum and glass. Anyway, the story point was that we had to see this connector fall apart and the fuel come out, spark on the road, and then the bad guy's car blows up. And all they had was these cars. I said, you haven't made a tricked out Volkswagen frame? Or this was 1986, a Pontiac Vega or a Chevy Astra. Pontiac Astra and a Chevy Vega. I think that's what it was. Anyway, yeah. those were the cars that were the frame. No, we're not going to rig a camera underneath a real car. Are you crazy? So Jock said, I've got an idea. Jock, by the way, for those who don't know him, does sound like Kermit the Frog, has a very raspy kind of high-pitched voice. And so this was a shot of something of this cable connection or hose connection doing this with the road screaming by in the background. And it was a close-up. And he said, let's use this. It was a 24-inch belt sander. I don't know where he found it. I don't think it was in his truck, but he, let's get one of those. And we literally put that was, and turned it on. That was the gray asphalt road, the quarter mile. And we had black blurbs on it, but to look like burnt rubber. And then this little thing, and sparked it with a Z18 or something. And then we cut to the bad guy and his car explodes. And so that was, see, Jock, it invested in you and me the same thing. that something doesn't necessarily need to be the sum of those parts. It has to be the sum of all its parts, but those parts can be different. And he's the guy who taught me on these porno films and working with him afterwards how to make lights with a pop rivet gun and aluminum and thing. And he, instead of wall spreaders, he made his own wall spreader that were sleeved aluminum pieces that you could have a 20-foot wall spreader in a 3-foot box and then put it together, mechano set, and then twist it and lock it. That became the wall spreader. Now it's 20 feet. And now you put it back in the box, put it in the truck. And everyone said, yeah, great idea. Yeah, we don't do that. Well, Jock did it. And then when it came to you, we were using Kino flows, which weren't really working. And you came up with this. The first idea was a rifle case, which opens up and you take it apart and you put four tubes here, four tubes there, and then mount them and they become fluorescent lights. Then you can diffuse them. But it was at, shooting Mighty Ducks, as I recall. We had this giant scoreboard hanging in an arena in Minneapolis, and it had skin on it that said "Welcome to the something games, the phony games we made for Disney." And so it was all backlit with 8-foot tubes, and it was on an angle like this, and it was on the ice before they put the skin on them, and they turned the lights on, and both of us stood back and said, now that's a good light. It was the first BFL. And we did the whole thing, brought it down, and then you and I started experimenting, and you're the guy who ran with it. And we had a thought to make it curved, and I eventually made a curved light through a curved diffusion, but that's what the pop tent was. So 27, was it? 27 four-footers?
27, yeah.
And that was in a frame. We tied in production services in Toronto who, in those days, it was LED, the LEDs didn't exist, just in flashlights, I'm sure. They said, well, let's make a frame for it and put the ballast inside the frame instead of the lunchbox. So the whole thing had 27 tubes, committed ballast inside the frame. You plugged it in, turned it on. And that was that beginning. We came up with this diffusion pup tent that fit on it, so that became a round light, and that's a mandate for me to make a light that you can set it up, plug it in, turn it on, and roll camera.
That's right.
The fuss factor is what kills us all. Somebody on the ladder, somebody with this thing, oh, you need to see some more black wrap, and then, oh, hold on, I need this, and suddenly one light has taken 20 minutes. I don't have 20 minutes, especially with kids or with dogs or actors who can't remember their lines. So the use of one light that grows into a system, that's what really attracts me. And that's what Jock was doing. He was making things that weren't just a one-off. And quite often people in the 10 years previous to this, their idea of making a light was to make what I call them soft boxes, light boxes, is to take a four-foot Kino, standard Kino, and put foam core around it, and then tracing paper, 1000H, and tape it all together, and use it, and then throw it away. And you think, well, no, we got this far. Why don't we make it so it's part of a system that now you can calibrate something? Three of those, two of those, one of these, and now we've just replaced the boxes have now been filled with LEDs. Any frame rate, any color temperature, any brightness, dimming is all possible. So that's what I think, Jock. I started in documentaries. You started in the circus. There's a structure to everything. If you're rigging some show in the circus, a tiger act or a acrobatic act, and for me, doing documentaries with literally nothing but a camera, no lights, no nothing. And that's where styrofoam that had a backside that was shiny for insulation. Oh, yeah, I could. And I had one, I'd fold it up, unfold it, and get all kinds of stuff. That's how you learn. And it's the necessity is the mother of invention. Well, there's lots of inventing to go. And, you know, no one asked for the iPhone. Nobody needed one. 2007, okay, here's the iPhone. Now we can't live without it.
That's right.
So if you find a hole and fill it, you're a genius. If you find a hole and people say, yeah, we don't need it, then, okay, well, I'll go somewhere else. I think that's what to me, as I say, my metaphor is tubes are 2x4s. That's how you structure everything. And having a 10K that you diffuse 7 times to get to a soft light is not only illogical, it's impractical. We all know how actors, especially if you do comedies or family shows, drenched in sweat, that's not a way to get someone to perform. Certainly not comedies. And as we found out doing Deck the Halls, we had a comedy to do. It was all set at night. We ended up with a 2.5-acre tent to make this outside now inside and turn the lights off. So now we could light it. That was the second motivation. The first one, the director said, people aren't funny at 3 a.m. Yeah, and he's right. And they were funny. Danny DeVito's a funny guy. What can I say?
That's right. And we had sections on that house, Danny's house. We had 125,000 LEDs on that that we could project in scene that we wanted to on there, which was pretty awesome. And I think that was when we were talking a lot about LEDs back then. The technology wasn't really there yet for anything. But let me ask you this then, because many, many times we had conversations about how lights had never changed from almost the beginning of film. There was just you flip the thing on, you flood and spot, and that was it. What are you most happy about with the progression of lights used on sets today?
I'm someone who understands engineering. And this is the way you have a circuit breaker or the old thread in fuses. When those overheated, it would pop. The only way to make light on a set was to feed electricity to a resistor, in which case it was a 10K bulb. And that would glow brighter and brighter and brighter. And there's your light. Putting that through a Fresnel, which was kind of the tradition from theater, and that would be focused. Flood or spot, but the shape of it, the character of it was a hard light. And that was how black and white movies traditionally were shot, with hard light and contrast. That was a Hollywood movie. Ironically, black and white film stocks reached a point in the same year, 1939, The Grapes of Wrath and Citizen Kane. Those film stocks, I believe, were 250 and 320. So you could do a lot more with indirect light. And if you look at The Grapes of Wrath, Greg Toland's work, a lot of it was soft and indirect. Color came in and said, went from 320 to 5. We've got to start all over again. It's all about inventing something that will not only interlock on the truck and on the set, but give you what you can count on as a character of light. And that is to say, The Godfather had the character of top light with shadows and a lot of mood. The French Connection had a lot of mixed colors. I'm trying to find something from that period. A film like Butch Cassidy was, Conrad Hall was the master of what he learned from John Seitz and other people, Charles Wheeler, who started ahead of him. And the three elements, key fill and backlight, was to replace the hard key with something soft that felt more source driven. And if you have a window light and a window in the shot and you have this hard studio light hitting them, me as a kid would look at that and say, I don't get it. And I started taking pictures when I was very young, and I was a projectionist all through school, and I learned a lot by just seeing movies over and over and over again. And instead of being bored, like watching a thing, look at that. Where did that shadow come from? And watching the work of Reutzman and Willis and Storaro and Conrad Hall and Ozzie Morris and Billy Williams. And you can look at a film like Women in Love, which was from the mid-70s. An incredible, it's still talked about, a fight, a wrestling scene in front of a fireplace at night. Oliver Reed and Alan Bates, and you watch it a third time, where did they hide the lights? How did they do that? And that you can get into the mechanics of it and come back to the artistic elements, the creative aspect to it all. But you and I started from the same in the same arena, with making your day and how do we get there? Because you can just turn around and point lights at actors and say, okay, let's roll. And that's how a lot of TV used to be done. I learned how to light by watching the streets of San Francisco. I should say I learned how to not light, because the intermediate light between HMIs and carbon arcs were expensive. They needed an operator for each head. At HMIs, you basically turn it on, it's daylight fill. In between was something maxi brutes, mini brutes, with multiple power beams. So you had a light that had 9 or 12, and then, you know, they got out of control. Dino lights were 144. The Wendy light was 144 bulbs. And all of those would, the nuts and bolts ones they used for TV, they had Faye filters on them, which were basically blue when they weren't really blue. That's how they would fill. So you went from having one shadow to 9 shadows or 18. It was terrible. And I kept looking at that thinking, this doesn't work for me. Because I had done documentaries and low-budget movies that didn't have 9 lights. And when in those days, if we had a scene that was in an office that looked out to the city, we didn't have the lights to balance to that view. So we would have a scene with two people talking. We do that coverage. And then do another scene, that coverage. Go to another office, do that coverage. And come back and do the master at 4:45 when the light balance came down outside, that we had enough light to make the difference. So there's many ways to catch the character. For me, it was all about, there's a scientific property that cannot be avoided. Just like the sun rises and sunsets or something called the rectilinear propagation of light. And it starts with the sun travels to us. We have a hard shadow. Light travels in straight lines. And what we're trying to do to get this no shadow, this hard one, to be a soft shadow, is to defeat that scientific property, to make light go around corners. So you can either diffuse it, hard light on the way in, and it softens, or take a hard light and bounce it, and that will diffuse it. And if it's not diffused enough then diffuse it again with a silk. The mechanics of it are pretty simple. An AD saying, so how you doing as you're building this giant castle of diffusion? Because once you diffuse something, there's spill everywhere. And now you're flying 12 bys just to get rid of, oh, now that's in the shot, so pull it back, I got to cheat this, and tick, tick, tick. So that's what I want to get rid of. And I, to be honest, I got bored looking at the best boy or the gaffer's knees on the ladder in the shot, and I want to get him out of there so I can block the scene with the stand-ins before the actors come in. And too many times I've had an AD bring in the actors, and there's 3 ladders on the set. And I always pull up my side and say, I didn't get the rerun where the actors come in the door and they climb up the ladder, and they go to the kitchen and climb up the ladder and go into the bed and climb up the ladder. Is that on your pages? Otherwise, you're going to have to fucking wait till these ladders leave. Come on. But it is. It's what I call art with a stopwatch. And whatever you and I can do, it isn't in a catalog. It's not in a Roscoe, a swatch book. It's up here. That's how you can see a problem and solve it before it gets there. And designing lights, for me, I've taken your hint and ganged together lights in soft boxes so that they are a unit. You put it on the stand, it's on wheels, you roll it in, you plug it in. There's our cross key. The backlight's already there. Let's dial it down. The kid's a blonde. Okay, let's dial a little more. Let's make it a little more blue for counterpoint. Okay, let's roll. And then the director feels and the actors feel like this is a shared experience rather than get out of the way. Here comes a 12 by, look out, you know.
Yeah.
We, as technicians, are invisible. And yet, you know, you've seen actors doing a scene and say, was that all right? You know, who are they looking at? Well, the rest of the crew, they're in a close-up. They're in an empty room, but there's 30 people there, and they're the people who are saying, do this, do that. They act, and then they say, was I all right? So they're in it alone, and not really. We're in it with them. Time is money, and that'll never change, I'm afraid.
That's right. If you could make a brand new lamp just magically appear in front of you, what would it look like, and what would it do differently than what we have out there today?
Well, I've been thinking about this a long time, and I want to point out to everyone who's watching this that I'm looking at Jay, And Jay is the guy who's designed more things than I've ever thought of. I would look at him in the dark, and he would be on the back of his sides, which was blank. He would be sketching something in elaborate detail with a fine tip pen, a design for this light, and then he'd go and make it, or a design for this rigging kit. And then he'd go to Matthews and say, okay, and then you manufacture it. I was doing the same thing with designing and manufacturing spreaders on the camera side, but it has to come up here. So the design is, like I said, if Steve Jobs was told nobody wants to take their computer home with them, and he said, yeah, you're right, forget it, we wouldn't be looking at a laptop, because someone else would say, yeah, you're right, there's no point. Bill Gates wouldn't have said that, so you've got to be careful as to who's got the bright idea. The bright idea I have is not to go where other people have gone. So let me get to that in a sec. Airy makes a great light. I always blank on the name, but you know, the sky panel. Mm-hmm. So to say, well, I'm going to make another one of those, or a light mat, I'm going to make one of those. Oh, no, they made them. I got stuck using LED strips on a show in Toronto that kept falling apart. These strips would line. They put them on a thing and they'd fall apart. The one line would go out and the whole thing would die. I don't know what it is. Like, okay, that's crazy. The perfect light for me is not to attack or to make one of those, but to make something that doesn't exist. And this comes out of your brain. Right now, I make my own Apple boxes that are Lego blocks more than anything. Five-sided Apple boxes, open bottom, they stack together. It's pretty simple. They're covered in Linex, rubber-coated sort of thing. So you can lock them together as an Apple box. That's all it is. My idea is to make a light that is 9 inches by 9 inches by 12 inches. And now it has sides, top and bottom, and back. The back is where the electronics are, and that is an entire LED diffusing power or light source. Everything else is translucent. On the ends, the top and the bottom, 4 receivers, male and female, 8 on the top, 8 on the bottom. And I came up with there's too many BLs out there, and I realized this is a brick light. But a BL is a brick light, a BL. So I know a glow, because I like lights to glow, a glow brick light, a GBL. So that's what that would be. That would be one light. And then you take another one and you'd attach it to this end and put another one on the top. And they would stick together and then have a plate that would fit on those Lego receivers that goes to a pin or a drop down. And that becomes the bale, the yoke. But this light can be 4 or 6 across, it can be 12 long, it can be 4 by 4, 4 by 5, it can be triangular, like a little pyramid, all battery powered or, you know, interlocking, so that they either feed power between them or they're self-powered and you plug them in, they're all LED, change the Kelvin. Now you can make an L-shaped light to go around a mat box. You can make a light that's it goes like this, that fits around. Pillow talk is the worst thing that we're asked to light. People talking in bed or beside a bed. I want to hide a light next to the side table. So let's use one of these and build it to the shot, just like fabric, but it's mechanical. That's the light that I would design. But I want to talk about lighting, how a scene motivates lighting, because that's really how I have to interpret. We have to interpret the script. And if any, I think hopefully most people have seen the film Scream with Drew Barrymore. And I point that out because Drew Barrymore, this is the first movie that any film started, no credits. And here's the big star. And at the end of the opening sequence, you kill the star? What? So we spent 6 nights, I should say. She got paid $1 million and we killed her before the movie started, that before the opening credits. The story said this girl is making popcorn, gets the phone call, and you know the story. Goes on and on, chased through the house, comes outside, gets killed. Okay, we get to the set, and she is wearing white. White pants, white sweater, and blonde hair. And she's a white girl. And this is a scary scene. So that's when I realized, and this is my philosophy when it comes to horror films. What you have to do is give the audience the baseline and make them feel safe. If it's a Nightmare on Elm Street, show them the kitchen, the living room, the kid's bedroom, of course, even the basement that goes down to the washing machine. Introduce it all so you can see it. And then when you come back, now you can start turning the lights out. Now you can scare somebody. If you start off with all the mood in all these places, shafts of light in the basement, you know, sunbeams and creepy shadows while they're eating breakfast, you think, well, where am I going to go when the bad guy's there? I'm already there. So when it came to Scream, the script said this girl is in peril, but it starts with her flirting with the guy. All right, great. Let's start it with it lit. I want to show the audience her. Inside her, she's capricious. She's cute. Oh, yeah. What's your favorite movie? Blah, blah, blah. And then one by one, dun, 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 dun. Now she goes to the TV room. We see that she comes back. We've changed the key to fill. We've added more shadows. The smoke is another issue. But what I wanted to do was take the light here, take it all the way up here, and what went from a halo backlight is now, and a soft key is a hard shadowy key, and more liners, more kickers. And once you introduce someone, you want to threaten them. And I can't threaten them if she's wearing white. I got to put her in shadow, and I have to put her physically in a place where she's up against a window, and then the bad guy's in the window, and he's lit in a certain way, and she's lit in a certain way. All these things progress, so the lighting tracks the story. By the time she is killed, she runs around the pool and around the house. The bad guy reaches around, grabs her, and stabs her in the chest. At a breakaway, or a plunger, you know, spring-loaded blade with a blood bag. And we ramped camera from 24 to 48. So as he runs around, he grabs her and then slows down. These are all the nuts and bolts of what we do. And most people, do you need that light there? You really need it? Yeah, I really do. You'll see in the end. Or, you know, when we did 10 Things I Hate About You, the director said, we lit it as a kind of a family drama, TV after school or high school drama. He came down, looked at the set, looked at the monitor and said, yeah, it looks great. Too dark for comedy. Call me when you're ready. And he fucking walked away. So we'd start the key to fill, pull scrims. And you and I were smart enough to know, let's have a double above this light on a set, but not in front of it. And let's have a scrim pulled out, a double pulled out. When he turns around, drop a single in and drop half the double down. And then by the time we roll, he's looking at what ends up being the proper modulation of key to fill. But it's all about character. It's funny with the Farrelly brothers knew what comedy was as writers, but they also knew that if their philosophy was kind of from Norman Lear, All in the Family kind of mentality, that if it's brighter, it's funnier. Therefore, brighter means funnier, which really means if it's not funny, it's too dark in their mind. So when we did Kingpin, which was the second of the first three, the golden years of the Farrelly brothers, Dumb and Dumber, Kingpin, and Something About Mary, there's always a story that all hope is lost, the darkness before the dawn. That's how stories are written. And when he loses everything, he loses the tournament, he loses his ring, he loses his hand, the whole. And I lit it darker, which is to say less fill. Not a silhouette, but the mood, the music went from major to minor, that kind of thing. And they complain, well, this isn't, it's not as, why is it? Well, because that's where the story goes. And they weren't seeing it as part of the story. The lighting actually contributes to that. The mechanics of getting it there, they still don't understand. But I think it was The Ringer, the last film I did with him. An explanation to everyone who doesn't know, when it comes to lighting, we know what foot candles are. It's literally a measurement. We know what T-stops are, and each progression of a T-stop from 2 to 2.8, that's half the amount of light to a four is half again. So from two to four is two, four. Four stops is very, very dark. When it comes to film and printing, all labs, I shouldn't say all labs, Technicolor was specific because they claim they created color. They had a YCM color system. Kodak had RGB, yellow, cyan, magenta was Technicolor. So for them, one stop was 7 points. One stop was 7 points. Everyone else was laboratory aim density. They were 6 points. We did the ringer at Deluxe. I was there with Peter and the timer. This is the final answer print, which means everything is going to look like this from this point on, striking 1,200 prints to go around the country. That was the film business, no problem. And I would talk to the colorist, let's bring this up a point, 1/6 of a stop, 2 points or 2 points darker, that's too bright with the sky, da da da. Everybody's good, we shake hands, see you at the premiere. An hour later, the cell phones hadn't been invented. I get home, there's a message on my answering machine. It's the timer saying, they changed everything. They changed everything. What did they change? Well, they said make it all two stops brighter. Now, one stop is this much. Two stops is this much. 2 points is this much. And they said, well, make it two stops. It was kind of put on the sunglasses and sit in the back row. That was completely out of control. But it turned out they'd had a test screening and the laughs weren't there. So it was the lighting's fault. Ah, so brighter is funnier. So that was my last time with the Fairleys. Shallow Hal was a film that Russell Carpenter did. He of the Oscar for Titanic. And he called me. They changed they did the same thing to him, a guy who won an Oscar. And they bumped everything up. So telling a story is one way. Shooting the blob, shooting scanner, shooting the dead zone, shooting scream, and then shooting Mighty Ducks, shooting old school. Those are all films that have different stories and require a different lighting approach. Making the day is totally different than making the movie, and most people on sets don't understand that. That's what's right. All this cable for? Why do you need a sandbag here? Yeah. You'll find out when the light falls on your head. Just, I don't tell you how to act. So don't tell us how to rig lights. It's pretty simple.
I only really have one more question for you. So maybe after this, Stephen has some questions from the viewers. I believe everybody makes mistakes during their careers. I mean, if you haven't made mistakes, you're doing something wrong if you haven't made mistakes. What's the one mistake you made that you wish you could correct?
That's more a philosophical question, and you know me and my life. In the film business, I've had ups and downs and a lot of lateral moves. So I'm not going to get too zen about it. And so I, in life, I made a lot of mistakes. In the film business, the mistakes truly were lessons in life that they taught me. You know, we learn by our mistakes. So I don't want to calibrate my life in saying, this is what happened, and I'll never do that again. There are rules, and then there are golden rules. Oh, rules are made to be broken. True enough, but golden rules, don't break those. That's how you know, it's all about simple things like flange focal depth or lighting ratios or literally don't put that videotape next to that magnet. You know, what are you doing? So to me, it's all, I've been, as a filmmaker, I started doing documentaries. I had nothing. And when electricians are different, and I joke with grips, but I'm serious. I tell them, you don't have to plug in sandbags. This is not that complicated. Now just get off your high horse and shut the fuck up. Oh, more gear talk. Okay. Quite often, I will drag people back to where I started in film school, shooting in Super 8. Didn't have any lights, and it all looked great. Then 16, wow, looked even better. And then you get a reflector, and then a little wheelchair dolly, and then a light, and then another light. 35 mil, it all looked great. But if we got rid of all of that and had nothing, it's still gonna look great. So people tend to make simple things complicated. And I like to make simple things simple. That's how you make your day.
Well, I know there's a lot of products out there on the market right now that reduce vibration, and they call them vibration isolation devices. You came up with one of the very first ones ever, and it was in the 80s. And I remember working with probably four different key grips with you where they would all each have to make one of these items. Can you tell people what you called that and what it did?
Well, this is rewinding to a point where Steadicam was expensive, and we were shooting a film called Youngblood, which was a hockey film. Peter Markle directed it, and this was with junior A hockey players, 18. They're ready, basically ready to go into the majors and or the minors, but they were big players. So we would Zamboni the ice, make it perfectly smooth. We had an ice dolly and would slide perfectly on the ice. These guys would come out and do their thing. We'd shoot one take. They chew up the ice, and then whoa, everything. Take two was got a Zamboni the ice again. And after lunch on the first day, it was evident we can't do this. So my key grip at the time was, let me think about who it was. That was 1984. But I thought, why don't we get some foam rubber, which is to say mattress foam, and compress it down so it isn't totally spongy, but it isn't locked, and it has a little give to it. And we started with two sheets of plywood, 4x4s, put the tripod on top of that on the spreader, and then squished it down a little with sandbags and did the shot. It was very hard to balance around this 4x4 because you couldn't stand on it. That would defeat the whole thing, but that worked perfectly. The vibration out of the ice was muted through this foam, and the shot was perfect. So we got to thinking and cut this square into a Y-shaped shape and the foam as well. And so the tripod now sat on that, and there was foam rubber, and it mounted on the skate dolly, and it worked perfectly. And so we had scenes in a parking lot and had a Western, and actors walking, we couldn't lay track for them to walk on. I said, well, let's try it on the Western. That worked as well. So it turned into a system. That was in Ontario in the 80s. It was called a trillium at that point, which is the provincial flower, three petals. And then it got a lot of different nicknames when it came to Hollywood. And everyone would throw it away. I don't know why. They'd make a new one. In Vancouver, there is it's like the county, but it's the greater Vancouver Regional District. And they have parks everywhere. And they all have the sign, the GVRD. And I said, well, let's call it that, the GVRD, the Grip Reduction Vibration Device. So that became the system that I still use. I shoot out of airplanes, trucks, car to car, tailgates of pickup trucks, station wagons. It vibrates things, and I kind of joke and say, let's do this the way cavemen used to make movies. You know, let's just use a piece of foam and a rock, and cavemen would say, they would say rock instead of roll because they didn't have film. Anyway, so that was one of the inventions that's gone on. All kinds of other ones. Do you have anything specific?
Well, no, I just remember that the name we always called it was the cow pie.
Yeah, that's because somebody painted, I said painted black, and they painted it brown. Yeah. couldn't get any black. That was Lauren Coral. And it looks like a cow pie. Okay, well, so I call it la tarte de vache, which it means in French, the pie of the cow, which is not quite cool enough to be not a cow pie. But anyway, I kind of looked at directors of photography in two different ways. And when I started at the CSC as a kid, I was shooting documentaries and political work, and it was just me. Sometimes I had an assistant. Sometimes I had someone to help me carry stuff. But I had a light kit of four redheads, one case, and a tripod and a bunch of cases, and that was that. And then I'd look around these guys at the CSC who would be talking about the commercial they did for GM or some life insurance commercial, which was elaborately lit. And I'm thinking, there are the silk scarf guys, these commercial guys, and there's the hands and knees guys, which is me. And that was the route I never took. I never got a silk scarf. I still operate a camera, and all the devices, the bazooka fittings, all the kind of deliberate rule breaking when it comes to dollies and cameras and viewfinders, that all came from Jock. And for those who don't know Jock Brandis, he was kind of the Yoda of independent filmmakers in Toronto and then in Wilmington. He gaffed a bunch of films for me until 83 and The Dead Zone. And Dino said, you know, I started in North Carolina. You're the guy. I'm Nietzsche. And so Jock disappeared and bred a whole bunch of guys like you and David and Bobby Huber was part of that
That's right.
Learning cycle. But Jock would look at things, literally take them apart. Why does this motor have to do this? Why don't we do this? And some of the inventions that I see I see Jock in you was, what did we call it? The pizza pie light and the spinning light.
In other words,
what I call a white knuckle speedometer. They'd hide a light there, and then the driver would. Yeah. And so you and I brainwaved and said, well, what if we had a light that moved? And let's mount it to the car or tow it, you know. And then that's the street light on the actor instead of the white knuckle thing. And you'd have some distant fill that was constant, but most of the time it was that. And then, well, let's get this passing storefront light. So we'd rig another thing that was a pizza pan. Literally, the first one was a pizza pan with a motor. And it had louvers in it that had different light bulbs and different gels. And this would be the passing lights now on that side as well. And then the backlight, we did one with strips, bat strips, we call them, on a chaser circuit. So people would drive and the lights would travel. Because there's nothing worse than you get the feeling somebody standing on the edge of a process trailer panning a 1K into the actor every 5 seconds, and that's supposed to be. So when we did old school, we did all kinds of movies like that. That would be the norm. And no one else has ever done that. I've never seen it other than green screen, where you make all these whirligig things. But that was kind of born out of this open mind of the Canadian Yoda, that is the 6'5" Yoda, that's Jock Brandis.
That's right. Definitely learned a lot from that, man.
Yeah, and there are rules, and then there are golden rules, and you can break any of the rules you want. But here's one thing that I learned about the Japanese as a culture. And there's only a slice of our world that is part of that culture, and it's a word called Kaizen, K-A-I-Z-E-N. And that is a philosophy within their culture to look at things, examine them, and philosophically, not mechanically, improve them. Just as an individual, certainly on an industrial level. And Honda's gone a long way from little putt-putt motorbikes to, you know, high-end Formula One cars as well as consumer cars. So, for example, there's nobody saying, oh, no, don't worry about that. Don't ever even think about that. If it's not in the Mole catalog, it doesn't exist. Or the Matthews catalog, it shouldn't exist. Well, that's the Steve Jobs thing. Yeah, I think people will want to take their computer home with them. I think people will want to have a phone that's a computer and a 5G or 3G receiver. And, you know, this Corona thing is proven that somebody said, well, I don't know, Skype. Yeah, maybe once in a while. No, all the time. Doesn't take much.
That's right. Well, I think we're pretty much done here. I want to thank everybody for joining us here at Quasar Science Livestream. And I don't know if there's any questions from any viewers that we could bring up. But it was great having you here today, Mark, and thank you very much.
Thank you for today and for the last, how many years? 2020 is 87. That's a long time.
That's right.
Long time. 33 years. Yeah, Matt was a little kid, and now he's a big kid.
That's right. Out shooting his own movies.
Yes. Well, and thanks again for the Quasar. It's not just a company, it's a mindset. And that's what I'm kind of trying to brainwave, that the way you look at something, it doesn't necessarily mean, oh, well, it says mole on it or it says Fisher on it. So, no, there's room for improvement for everything. If there wasn't, and I joke around, I say to grips, you know, if somebody fell out of the sky from the 12th century and landed on a set in the 21st century, they'd be right at home. Bags of sand, blocks of wood, iron bars, rope, come on. This is the 21st century. That'll never change. The electrical aspect and the camera aspect is the foundation for change. So thanks for being part of that change.
Thank you, Mark. It's been great.
I'll jump
and
back in
other
here,
than
gentlemen.
Looking at a screen and pressing something that says goodbye, I guess that's what I do.
I guess.
Well, yeah.
Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Steven Strong, I wanted to thank
Take
you
care.
Very much. Bye.
Thank you.
And there it goes. Click.
Thanks again, Jay Aller, for doing that. Thanks, everyone, for attending the Quasar Alchemy live stream with Mark Irwin. Appreciate everyone being in here. Thanks for all your time. Join us next week for our next live stream. Look forward to that, and thank you very much.